Welcome students, now we are going to look into a very interesting topic of renal neoplasia. Renal neoplasia can be classified into two broad categories, benign versus malignant. Benign lesions can be of three types, renal adenoma, renal angioma and a combination, that is renal angiomyolipoma. Malignant neoplastic lesions of the kidney are important from our point of view. Wilms tumor, Gravitt's tumor, transitional cell carcinoma of renal pelvis and squamous cell carcinoma of renal pelvis. We are here mainly going to discuss about two important entities. One is a Wilms tumor and second is Gravitt's tumor or RCC. First we'll begin with Wilms tumor. Another name for Wilms tumor is nephroblastoma in children. Origin. It originates from embryonic nephrogenic tissue. It originates from primitive undifferentiated mesodermal tissue and also originates from Wolfian body. That is why the name nephroblastoma. Etiologically, the genetic background is deletion of short arm of chromosome 11. Now, as you are aware, P stands for short arm, Q stands for long arm. So 11p deletion, 11p is a tumor suppressor gene actually for Wilms tumor. Once this gene is deleted, it leads to formation of Wilms tumor. Usual age of the child at presentation is 3 years. 90% of these tumors are solitary and unilateral in nature, but in 10% it can have a bilateral presentation. This tumor can show familial tendency in few, and for children, second most common abdominal neoplasm. Now the clinical features of this tumor. It is a rapidly growing abdominal tumor which will grow while the child's general condition will deteriorate or fall down. The mass of this tumor is quite enormous as compared to a small child who is suffering from this. Half of the children or 50% of these children will have fever, most prominent feature. As fever disappears, the tumor is considered to be dissolved or removed. So fever has a good prognostic indication for us. Hematuria. It will progress as the tumor will engulf into the renal tissue, initially from the collecting system to renal parenchyma and eventually the entire kidney. So it will be a painless and progressive hematuria. Investigations. Basic important biochemical investigations for this tumor is CBC. Urine routine and microscopy will show malignant cells and casts and gravels and hematuria. Culture sensitivity will also detect concomitant infection in the kidney, and cytology of the urine will show malignant cells. Renal function tests. If the tumor is small, there will not be any compromise on the renal function tests, but if the tumor is larger, then there will be some compromise and some sort of renal failure evident in these children. One needs to understand also that this tumor metastasizes to liver, so one needs to also study the liver function test in children. Radiologically, ultrasonography of abdomen and pelvis will give a broad outline about the tumor location, tumor size, other morphological features and morphology of affected kidney. Intravenous urography is again considered to be very important, but now CT scan abdomen and pelvis plane plus contrast gives better delineation of tumor, helps in staging, hence considered as a gold standard investigation of choice in Wilms tumor. So CT abdomen and pelvis is very, very important. Now we'll look at the pathological perspective of this tumor, gross and microscopic. Grossly, how the tumor will look. The tumor surface will be covered by thin-walled veins. Cut section of the tumor will show compressed viable renal parenchymal tissue. Tumor is pink in color, sometimes white or sometimes in combination pink to white. There will be areas of hemorrhage and areas of necrosis evident. renal pelvis will be intact in the earlier stages, but as the tumor will increase in size, the specimen will show that the entire renal parenchymal system, that is the pelvic collecting system, is destroyed and pelvis is broken. Microscopically, what we can look is epithelial cells and connective tissue. Occasionally, one can actually get fragments of bone, cartilage and muscle fibers also in this pathology. Large quantity of embryonic mesenchymal cells have been identified on the microscopic examination. Now, after CT scan, one will be able to stage the disease. We have National Wilms Tumor Study Group, which will stage the disease into five different categories. First level, tumor is confined to the kidney. Level 2, tumor infiltrating into the renal parenchymal tissue. Initially, in the first stage, the tumor is well encapsulated and in the renal tissue, but not infiltrating into the parenchyma. Level 2 is infiltrating into the renal parenchyma, engulfing slowly, slowly, collecting system. Then tumor has gone beyond the kidney. It is in the gyrotas fascia, but sometimes also invading into the adjacent abdominal organs, but confined to abdomen, that is stage 3. Stage 4 is blood dissemination or hematogenous dissemination or hematogenous metastasis of this tumor into lungs, which is the commonest route. This is very important for MCQ, that lungs form the commonest route of metastasis for Wilms tumor. Liver, uncommon. Bone, again uncommon. And brain, the rarest. So again, important to know, brain is the rarest and lung is the commonest site for metastasis for Wilms tumor. And stage 5 is considered when the bilaterally kidneys are involved with this particular pathology. Now, what treatment options do we have? Usually, nephrectomy is a treatment of choice. In nephrectomy, we remove the ipsilateral affected kidney along with the fibrofatty tissue in the gyrotas fascia. We also remove the gyrotas fascia. We remove the ipsilateral pedicle, that is the vascular and the pelvis, and a portion of the ureter. Now, this surgery is followed by radiotherapy. Chemotherapy is also advocated in few patients with lot of lymph nodes in the adjacent area, that is called as adjuvant chemotherapy, which consists of two main drugs, actinomycin and vincristine. But it is optional. It is not at every patient of Wilms tumor has to undergo chemotherapy. Partial nephrectomy is reserved for tumor which is bilateral, because as you are aware, both kidneys we cannot just remove. It is not compatible with life. So in this situation, our aim is to salvage as much as possible. So here, what we need to do is a renal angiogram to delineate exactly how much is the tumor getting engulfed and the kidney how much is viable. So we can achieve a partial nephrectomy. Prognosis is considered to be good if the child survives beyond 18 months or more after the surgery. Now, this rule is known as Collins rule. This they can ask sometimes in the MCQ, that Collins rule is very good prognostic hallmark for Wilms tumor. 80% survive under the age of 1 year. So if the child survives and he or she is 4 years old, it means that the tumor has been totally extirpated and patient will not have another Wilms tumor, because it originates from the embryonic nephrogenic tissue. As the child will grow, the embryonic tissue will be converted into adult tissue and there won't be any occurrence of Wilms tumor. Now we proceed to our main topic, that is renal cell carcinoma, which is very, very important for descriptive as well as for MCQ point of view. There are various names given to this fascinating neoplasm of kidney. I will give you a small picture. Now in this picture, the schematic diagram showing presence of RCC or renal cell carcinoma engulfing the upper pole of the kidney. 45-50% of the times, upper pole has been observed to get affected with this particular tumor. Hence, the name given to the tumor is hypernephroma. Another name given is the Gravitz tumor, because Paul Gravitz, the pathologist, invented or described it in detail. Third thing, the name given is clear cell carcinoma, because majority of the times, if you see the histological pattern of cells present in the RCC, they are of clear variant. 80% of the patients will have clear cell variant in RCC. And lastly, also called as adenocarcinoma of kidney, as it evolves from renal tubular epithelial cells, which are adenomatous. Etiology: male to female ratio is 2:1. Age, common age group is between 50 to 70 years of age. Genetically, 3P is a tumor suppressor gene, so deletion of short arm of chromosome 3 leads to formation of RCC. So 3P deletion means RCC formation. It arises from proximal renal convoluted tubular epithelial cells, hence the terminology, that is adenocarcinoma of the kidney. Now, what are the high risk categories? High risk categories are patients or people who are cigarette smokers, pipe or cigar smokers, and few industrial workers like cadmium factory workers. Familial: von Hippel-Lindau syndrome will have close relation with this RCC formation. In this particular syndrome, the tumor will be bilateral and tumor will be multifocal, and it can also be associated with polycystic kidney disease of adult variant. Right kidney is more commonly affected from the left kidney. Clinical features: clinically, a classical triad is observed in RCC. One is a loin pain, second is presence of lump or swelling at the renal angle, and third is painless and progressive hematuria. As the tumor will engulf the renal parenchyma slowly, hematuria will increase, but most importantly, it will be painless hematuria. A typical presentation: 1/4 of these patients suffering from RCC will have no local symptoms whatsoever. It will be just an incidentaloma or incidental finding found out on a routine screening of the abdomen for some other cause. Many of these patients can actually present with pyrexia of unknown origin or fever of unexplained origin. If patient is having fever, say for a period of 1 month, and one cannot determine what is the cause, is it bacterial, is it viral, one should always look for RCC, that is some renal origin. Then patient will have constitutional symptoms like body ache, malaise, sensation of not feeling well-being. Few patients will have nephrotic syndrome such as proteinuria, edema feet, puffiness of face. Secondary features can also be sometimes evident, such as anemia due to prolonged loss of blood and malignant cachexia. Now, this entity, this RCC, has special features also. We call it as paraneoplastic syndromes. Now, what are these paraneoplastic syndromes? Kidney as such secretes various substances besides formation of urine, and those substances play various regulatory roles in the body, such as release of prostaglandins, release of erythropoietin. Now, this tumor, by engulfing the renal parenchyma, also secrete these substances in large numbers and give rise to these paraneoplastic syndromes. So, patient may have polycythemia due to excess production of erythropoietin. Patient can have hypercalcemia due to calcitonin release. But all these paraneoplastic syndromes can be cured after one removes the tumor. There is one more syndrome which is pertinent to this RCC, that is called as Stauffer's syndrome. In Stauffer's syndrome, there is focal hepatic necrosis, there is leukopenia on biochemical examination, and abnormal liver function tests, and patient will have fever. All these symptoms are totally reversible when one performs nephrectomy and removes the primary tumor. So this syndrome is a prognostic indication. If the Stauffer syndrome persists, it means bad prognosis. Investigations: again, we have seen biochemical investigations, that is complete blood count, most important to detect anemia, leukopenia, urine routine microscopy to see various crystals, gravels, infections, culture sensitivity to isolate the microorganisms responsible for concomitant UTI, and cytological investigation to detect malignant cells and confirm our diagnosis. renal function tests. These are the rapidly growing tumors, so there will be some sort of a renal compromise evident. So usually creatinine or blood urea nitrogen is marginally elevated. And liver function tests, very important. Radiologically, ultrasonography as a baseline investigation will give basic primary features. IVU, very very important. But now CT scan plays gold standard role. Abdomen and pelvis, plane plus contrast. Now, based on CT scan, we can now stage the disease. Now, we have to classify and stage. So, what is the classification? There's a Holland's modification of Flokes and Kardeşky. It classifies the RCC into four main categories. Tumor, that is stage 1 or level 1, is tumor limited to renal parenchyma. Stage 2, tumor beyond the kidney but still limited within the gyrotas fascia. Stage 3, tumor extension in adjacent structures such as ipsilateral renal vein or IVC, lymph nodes, that is in the renal vicinity, or both, that is renal vein extension as well as the lymph node load. And level 4 or stage 4 is tumor spreads beyond gyrotas fascia with distant metastasis. Now the treatment. What are the treatment options available for RCC? Surgery forms the mainstay for treatment of RCC. Radical nephrectomy is considered to be the gold standard in treatment and management of RCC. Now, what do you mean by radical nephrectomy? What are the components of radical nephrectomy? Radical nephrectomy means one needs to remove the affected tumor, affected kidney in totality, along with all the fibrofatty tissue in the gyrotas fascia. One needs to excise the gyrotas fascia. One needs to remove the renal pedicle, that is artery, vein and the lymph nodes in the vicinity. Then one needs to remove classically upper half of ureter and ipsilateral adrenal. Now that is why the name radical nephrectomy. However, nowadays for better understanding of the tumor, one can actually salvage adrenal ipsilaterally and we can remove just upper one third of the ureter. No need to remove up to half of the ureter. So we do a modified radical nephrectomy for nowadays. Meticulous lymph node dissection is not required in RCC because the lymphatic dissemination is quite unpredictable. As you are aware, the disease can disseminate in the lymphatics by the phenomenon of embolization and permeation. For RCC, sometimes it can go in a cranial fashion, sometimes in caudate fashion. So one cannot predict that only this node is present, so I have to remove this, I have to remove this. No, it's not possible. So lymph node meticulous dissection or a wide lymphatic dissection is avoided. It will increase the morbidity for the patient. These tumors are less radiosensitive. Few advocate chemotherapy, but again these tumors are not so chemosensitive. But yes, some surgeons have tried with cisplatin. What is important and interesting in the treatment is use of biological modifiers or immunomodulators, or we call it as immunotherapy, which is recommended with tumor necrosis factor, that is TNF alpha and interleukins alpha 2A. Both will have impressive outcome, especially when used in combination, that is TNF and interleukins alpha 2A will give a synergistic much positive response. Now treatment for special situations and special surgeries, there is one special entity called as nephron sparing surgery. Now what is that? In simple words, is nothing but the renal salvage surgery. Now there are certain situations or special scenarios in which we need to save the kidney, such as what are the different headings with which we know this surgery. One is simple enucleation of the tumor. Polar nephrectomy is also considered as nephron sparing surgery. Wedge resection of the kidney is also considered as nephron sparing surgery. And even the major transverse resection is also part of the surgery. Indications. The indications are bilateral tumor disease, because as one is aware that one cannot have total nephrectomy on both the sides, not compatible with life. So we try to save the kidney as much as possible. Again, renal angiography is very, very important in the situation of salvage surgery. Tumor identified in solitary functioning kidney. That is the worst scenario. We have to save that kidney at any cost. So nephron sparing surgery is very, very important. Now, this tumor going into the ipsilateral renal vein, it has a tendency of further going and having a progression into IVC, that is inferior vena cava. Now, sometimes this imposes major threat for treating surgeon. So we stage the disease accordingly. And if this situation we are anticipating, then in that scenario, we should have a CVTS team standby with us. One cannot be just heroic and go ahead and operate and remove the entire tumor mass along with the tumor thrombus, that is engulfing the IVC. What are the findings with these patients will have? Typically nephrotic syndrome like picture, like proteinuria, edema fit, hypertension, and renal failure or renal insufficiency. We usually use a three clamp method when we are treating this IVC thrombus. It's very important that first you have to clamp the opposite renal vein, vena cava, proximal and distally, and then try to mobilize the kidney or the tumor. Because what happens, once you try to mobilize the tumor or kidney, the tumor will disseminate. Sometimes this thrombus, if you try to handle first, it can just get dislodged and form an embolus, which is quite life-threatening. This tumor embolus is not good. It can sometimes get lodged in the superior vena cava or into the right atrium also. Sometimes in extensive cases, the tumor thrombus has been seen till the going to the superior vena cava, almost reaching to the right atrium. Now in which we have to have a cardiopulmonary bypass surgery. We have to explain to the patient very carefully that this is a very, very special scenario and you have come in a very late stage. We can still operate and cure you, but yes, we have to go for a bypass. And for that, you require a meticulous planning for this RCC. So, to summarize, what is important? Wilms tumor and RCC are both very, very important renal tumors, renal malignant tumors. Wilms in children, RCC in adults, both can be treated. Surgery forms the mainstay in both the scenarios, and usual outcome is good in both Wilms and RCC, provided you plan your surgery, you plan your management plan, and you choose your options wisely. Thank you.